Now, with great pleasure, I introduce the second speaker for this evening, Sisowath Menchandevy, who is the Vice-Rector of the Royal University of Fine Arts in Cambodia, and also the Director of the Heritage Center under the Ministry of Culture and Fine Arts. Devi is an architect by training, and having received a master's degree in architecture from the École Nationale Supérieure d'Architecture, I've messed it up now, de Toulouse in France, where she specialized in the conservation of built heritage, and she will be defending her PhD in October. She's an expert in conservation and restoration of architectural heritage, and one of her main interests in preserving the architectural heritage of Phnom Penh. And she will enlighten us on the conservation and enhancement of the urban heritage in Phnom Penh in Cambodia. So without much further ado, Devi.
Thank you, Noel. So, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. First, I would like to thank to the director of the SEAMEO SPAFA, Dr. Ruzaya Apakon, that he gave me this opportunity to talk to about the conservation and the enhancement of the urban heritage in Phnom Penh. So let me start by showing the map. Cambodia is located in the Southeast Asia, and also it have a border nearby the Thailand, Laos, and Vietnam. In 1431, the capital city of Cambodia was from Angkor in Siem Reap province to Phnom Penh. So from the late 15th to the 19th century, Cambodia experienced a long period of unrest and something like trouble and the territorial division leading to establish the different capital such as Phnom Penh, then Tuol Basan, Lung Vet, and Udong, and turn back to Phnom Penh again and again. So Phnom Penh also being the center of political power and remain a major economic and cosmopolitan city. In 16th century, we noticed that the presence of Chinese, Malay, or Annamite in the city. So that we as described by Portuguese or Spanish and French missionary at that time. So before start speaking about Phnom Penh in detail, I would like to briefly introduce you the richness of the Angkorian post-Angkorian heritage. So some of this three kind of architectural heritage that our office that we can call a heritage mission has been worked and be defined as follow: the religious heritage, vernacular heritage, and urban heritage. So for the religious heritage, we see many ancient monasteries that the Cambodian call Wat. It's which are still remaining in some provinces in Cambodian. So this is the main building in the Wat that we call Prahvihia. I just only chose the main building in the pagod. In the monastery, I would like to say monastery because pagoda is the main building in the monastery. So all this building was built around 1890. So with the traditional style, in particularly the roof and all the decoration on the facade. Inside, also inside the building, the technique of the painting is on the wall, on the column, or is largely used for today. And regarding to the vernacular heritage, it can be found mainly in three provinces, namely Battambang, that Kampong Cham and Croches. So I just mentioned on the map. So where this type of architecture still stand, and based on the documentary and our research work, there are five different types of Khmer houses. So the traditional Khmer houses. The left photo that I put here, it's I think it's the house which was built around 90 years old, that in Chlong, in Croches, near Mekong River, in here, and with 100 columns. So I think it's quite a big house in Cambodian. The practically feature is the technique amount up to the wood element, that the technique of the wood assembly. So such as the wall, also the ceiling, the stair, the door, the window, it's at that time we have a beautiful design. So after the light construction of wood, the building in the colonial periods also has a great interest of architectural and urban value, as well as the remarkable heritage value. So here I would like to show you some different building like houses, the resident houses, or some office at that time. The resident in the Battambang province, that this building have a long history, more than a century. Concerning to the Chevirban family, is that mean the Mandarin that works with the king at that time. So his family built this building in 1905. And move later on to Pachamburi in Thailand. So now look at the Chinese shop house. As you can see, this kind of architectural style anywhere in Southeast Asia. So the first one is from wood, and after that in the bricks. The last one is characterized by the independent period in 1960. So the late King Norodom Sihanouk abdicated and became a head of state at that time. So he launched a policy to implement major projects through the country and also in the capital, the center on the number of the successive plan, and the first 5 year plan in 1958 to 1963 profoundly changed the face of Phnom Penh. So with the landfill and also the waterworks project to fill, but this project, the water project, is it's initially since 1920. In this period, we can call some Songkhumrit Nijum period, that in 1996, because we have 1953, we have independent from France. So at that time, we call a new Khmer architecture. The new Khmer architecture really was showcased. New structure was built, like school, pagoda, factory, or some theater, and building also the collecting building. So turn back to the history of Phnom Penh city. As mentioned in the notes by Vidla Box, you can see the view of habitation or dwelling and what priority to their relocation. So you can see the pagoda and the small dwelling. Look at the map at map in the 15th century, sketching by Jacques Das around 1910 or 1920. This the King Phnom Penh permanently abandoned Angkor as the capital, and he moved first to Tuol Basan, like I saw in the map, the first slide. He moved to Tuol Basan, now in Kampong Cham province. I think Kaska also talked. But heavy flooding at that time forced him to move to Phnom Penh again. So this site was the Mekong and Tonle Sap meet. So it rich in both spiritual and also political symbolism. So you have Tonle Sap and the Mekong River. So the foundation of Phnom Penh by the concept or the idea why they choose this place to the city after Angkor. So it, firstly it's water. And after that, it's Phnom Penh that we call the highest place in the sacred place. So it's the two ideas that the king chose it. So after that, the king was has a major development work undertaken. Like you see already in detail, some evidence show that from prehistoric time, Phnom Penh region has been continuously occupied. So the particularly two major sites show evidence in this occupation. The first one is Chiang Ai site that Sakda talk right now. So the second, the other archaeological site is also bear witness and development of the capital prior to the 13th or 14th century in the Angkorian Tower located in the Wat Unalaum. It's not so far from Royal Palace. It's the north of the Royal Palace as well. So also in this map, it's very interesting. Between 1865 and 1889, Phnom Penh was really nothing more than a juxtaposition of villages or Dutch huts sketching along the river edge and from north to the south. It's Main Street here that we call Grand Rue in French, but we can call the large street. So it's the first street in the city. Another one is the old Royal Palace. It's next to the Wat Unalaum. So the monastery of Unalaum, and then move to the south. It's the Royal Palace nowadays. So the first one is here, and the second it's here. So at that time, it was set up by symbolical opposite of the four faces. the river initially built via the Mahaprasad, we call Mahaprasad or Pratinyang Tivya Vinchai, the throne hall, and also Prasad Cameron, the Kenya resident, the throne hall at that time, and the Kenya resident, and also the place for the forming arts that the Queen Mother is have a forming art in this building that we call Prasad Chanchaya, the Royal Ballet Performing Art. So this first complex was inaugurated by the King Norodom in 1871. That he, after that, they also set up the Napelong Pavilion, that we the gift from Emperor Napoleon III to the King Norodom at that time. So in 1846, Phnom Penh was used by the protectorate and had three zones this time. So the resident superior, I don't know in English how to speak resident superior, Gilles Piquet, the project to put in the semicircular around the French Quarter. And so they put the semicircular canal, was the project was stopped and because of the money shortfall, something like that. And after that, the second resident superior, Ijun de Vianneville, took the project and he started to work at 1890, yes. The purpose of the pyramid of canal is provided to the wastewater collection, and after that also to supply the soil that need to fill in the land blocks that the future lot for the new subdivision, and also to protect the European area at that time. So this canal have three main functions. It's divide Phnom Penh into distinct sections. So we can see the friend initially conserved in the so for the friend area initially conserved in 1886, as in 1886 the we start the land works for plot near the in the south of Phnom of mountain. It's here, and so we can see in the French Quarter or administrative area that purpose of the it's how to separate into a block into distinct zone into the first one it's a friend governor friend zone, and the second one is the royal palace and the Chinese zone, because the king give the land to the friend at this and here, and the center give to the Chinese community. So we can see here three quarter it's different French quarter or Annamid or Catholic they stay here, the Chinese in the center because have two market. And the around the Royal Palace is the Khmer area. So as landfill works move along, new lot of land become buildable. So the colonial administration has constructed new building in European quarter, in European area. You can see here a lot of building, administrative building, like post office, the treasurer, the treasury, or some like a police station also in around this. And also the bank. So this building is such facility to give the protectorate, the structure it required to affirm the new capital in the region. And in Chinatown, the old shop pile was demolished and rebuild the new one in the brick. And also the new urban planning provide to the opportunity to pull down the houses and the riverbank, on the riverbank, and enlarge also the promenade on the river. So a new building was set up at that time, especially in 1917. The National Museum in Phnom Penh was constructed, and also some colonial style in at that time was, and also the mansion house that nearby the UNESCO it's also stand till now. And starting in 1921, Phnom Penh experienced another development with the arrival of Indo-Chinese architect and urban planner. The architect is Agnes Ebra. Agnes Ebra is he was a member of the French Urban Planning Department in Hanoi. So in 1923, he was created Department of Planning in Hanoi, and he's designed the city of Hanoi, the master plan of Hanoi. And after that, he came to Phnom Penh and he start work on the city. So at that time, the Phnom Penh have a problem of sanitary condition. So it was worsening in Phnom Penh. Up to the document, they said more than 600 people has died of the plague. So Ebra start to work in the city. So he got busy enforcing in 3 points. The first is development of the city, the improvement, and also an extension. So he worked on the administrative boundary. So he started work at here. So all the red color is the Ernest Ebra project. So to reduce the overpopulation at that time, he tried to extend the city via the west part. And he advocated filling the perimeter of the perimeter canal, extending the city to the west by putting the new access here, from here to here. And they start to have a project of the train station here, and a new boulevard here, and also he extend also the Chinese area. But another project is in the Chiu Chung Wa Peninsula. Ernest Ebra plan to build a new quarter, or European quarter, the new one here. So we can see in green color, it's the project of Agnes Ebra that was carried out. So in practice, actually it carried out But the main achievement was filling the canal perimeter. The future train station, it's here. And doing groundwork on Mish Boulevard, it's the Munivung Boulevard actually, in here. And also the main avenue is to the Phnom, to the new location of the central market in here. But another project is in the new area, the new European quarter, never saw any development. So following the map of 1940 and 1950, the city extend the westward. The canal built backfill and in 1930 or 1931 and create a new city streets, forming a meeting point for the French and the Chinatown. So the building also was set up all around the mountain, the Phnom Don Penh, and also in west part. So after colonial period, after having received independence in 1953, in order to respond to the social and big growth projected by the Prince Norodom Sihanouk, head of state, and innovated from the architecture up here, in the fruit of close cooperation with the Prince and the Van Leeuwen, is the Khmer architect, trained in France. So the latter Van Leeuwen, architect, urban planner, and also rector of Rufa, sought to translate the vision of the father of independent had for his kingdom. So he a matching of the ancestral technique of Khmer civilization and the functionalism of the Le Corbusier, one of his intellectual model at that time. So the Khmer traditionally use steels, the isolated roofs, and the clay bricks, so suit to the tropical climate, where ventilation and the shelter from the sun and also the rain. So the tradition was merged with modernity, featuring the addition of slick line, reinforced concrete and glass. Like you see in the picture, you can the Khmer architectural, the new Khmer architectural that we call 1960s style of architecture. So the independent movement inspired from the Bakong Temple in Siem Reap province, and also the theater, the conference, and the university compound in Phnom Penh was constructed. In order to make a complete break with protectorate period, the Prince decided also to create a new site of power. So, and at the Chamkamon, we call Chamkamon complex, is the new residence of the Prince Sihanouk at that time. So, it was built in 1950 to 1960 by Khmer architect called Lu Ban Hap. He came up with the overall plan of the complex, and which he designed in line with the extension of Norodom Boulevard in here. So it's the complex of new of Prince Sihanouk, it's in here. So he designed into spaces that reserved for the public, to the south, and the private sector to the north part. So for the public is have state resident and said reception or stay of the distinguished guest. And the north part is the royal resident, the resident of the family of King Sihanou. So by conclusion, this map shows the development of city from 1867 to the 1966. The city was extended from the east to the south. We can see that the first city was urbanizing, and after that we developed from three quarter and we extend to the west. I would like also to show the urban development today in Phnom Penh. So as you can see here, more and more satellite city was built, was constructed in the city itself and in the suburb of the city. So I just mentioned the ancient city, and after now they backfill on the lakes, and they have a project to rebuild a new satellite city. So we have around Phnom Penh, maybe more than 10 satellite city. And also in the main street, main boulevard, that we call Boulevard Premanivong, the tower or the skyscraper are in the process of building. So they completely change the aspect of the urban in Phnom Penh, in old city. So I will present you the problematic and the proposal on the protection of urban heritage in Phnom Penh. In summary, the Heritage Center was created in 2005. It has two departments in the Heritage Center. So one is the Heritage Mission, just you see here, in the Heritage Mission. And the second one is, another one is the Heritage, Regional Heritage School. So this center is the public institution under the Ministry of Culture and Fine Art, and funded by friend project called SSP, Visiting Embassy of Friend to Cambodia. So the Regional Heritage School was created to train the young architecture, engineer or archaeologists in the field of conservation and restoration, the built heritage and also the landscape. The heritage mission, the main object is as follow: in order to safeguard the urban vernacular and religious heritage. So it work on inventory and identification of urban heritage. He established also the safeguarding plan and the restoration work plan, and on-site work intervention, analyzing and monitoring for the public and private building. After that, the communication and awareness about the heritage protection, like tour guide or conference, seminar, or a documentary article and some exhibition in the evolution of the city. So actually, Phnom Penh is entering in a very fast development period. That in the previous slide we can see. We can saw a number of new satellite city in the center and around was constructed. So which are currently built. So we found the urban heritage in Phnom Penh is affected by the several factors. So like demolition, the lack of maintenance, or sometimes it's abandoned. And also this appearance of known house is very important for Cambodian people. And also the inflation of the land prices is the main factor in the conservation and the restoration of the heritage building. And after that, the dominance of the manufactured material or predominance of a new architecture model. For example, in this slide, the building was built around 1890 with the high historical and also architectural value. And also the localization is very important. It near the Naga Bridge, it near the European area. And this building, it was demolished 3 years ago. So you can see a new business start here. You can see the old picture after the construction. And the photo in 2012, see, and now. So some major building in administrative and royal palace area has been abandoned also. So like a former police office, this building built around 1930. That we call in the architectural style that it the Art Deco style, and another building is in front of Royal Palace that it's the former court office since King Norodom period. So it has been used for the hotel after Pol Pot was, and now they abandoned the. This building. So it's the same situation like the first one. Furthermore, in the main problem today, like I said, is the lack of knowledge transmission. So woodwork, the technique of wood element assembly, or the technique of lacquer or of gold leaf are rarely seen in today, in building today. And for the urban landscape, we can see the photo here is the Norodom Boulevard. It's the one of the main boulevard in Phnom Penh that connect from the mountain, the Phnom Don Penh, to the Independence Monument. So we can call this axis is the historical axis in Phnom Penh. But like you see in the photo, behind of the monument, we have two towers. So they lose the monument. We cannot give the value of the monument. And other side of Phnom Penh, normally in this boulevard, we have a building, a garden, and the fence. But now, some new construction do not respect the alignment. So they some part the parcel and move over build on the location of the fan. But on the other side, we also we are not disappointed because they also have renovates and restoration building for new purpose, like some old building here, and now they already renovated and also used for the commerce. So based on the 1996 law, we on the protection of the tangible heritage. The heritage mission is in the process of working on safeguarding plan of three districts in Phnom Penh. The fourth one is the district around the post office that we call post office district, and the second one is the Chinese office or Chinatown, and the district around the Royal Palace that we call Khmer district. So through the documentary research and on-site analysis, we create the inventory sheet for each building. That the inventory sheet are divided in two kinds. The first one is that we call the simple inventory, and another one we call in detail sheet. That for the main building or the remarkable building. So in the sheet, we note all the information concerning to the plot, to address or identification of the building, the plan, the facade, and the material. Also the technique in detail, and the important thing is the interest of the building, the value of the building. After the inventory work, we also established the date of the construction or the datation plans that we call. So the map and the plan of architectural interest. So the different color mark the interest of the building of interest. So the black color, that means the exceptional building. The second is remarkable or very important or very interesting or indifferent or till without interest. So it's sometimes it's very complicated for indifferent, because some experts said what that mean in indifferent here. So indifferent, that mean the building can be demolished or can be conserved. So it's not if we conserve this building, it also include in the context of all the block. And also the protection map show the building to be conserved or to be protected or to be improved sometime. To the safeguarding map also propose the measure of the specific intervention, so that the building to be conserved, but some part must be improved or some part must be take out, because it the adding so it we have all the establish all the state of the building. So at the end of the work, we have also the recommendation that it's providing to the owner to respect all this recommendation. So this work provide for each building, sometimes for each building, or if the block is not so important, we can make the recommendation of the block. And so the recommendation is also reorganize the plot, or sometimes it's modification of the facade or demolition of one part that added after. So besides the technical document, we also work on the restoration and of the heritage building site, like Bopana Center or National Museum, or some privates have for the restoration or renovation of this building. And also, we also study in detail for the preliminary of the restoration work. So we have a safeguarding tool before the restoration. So like here, I just give some example for the National Museum. So in detail. So the first one, it's the start with, we try to collect all information of the building that start from the first time of the building that was constructed, and after the evolution of the building that we call archaeological plan also, like in, so the first one, it, and after that they put, they added tubing, and after that also they change here, they put the one store. So the documentary is very important for us to find and to collect all this information. And after that we study about the diagnostic of the building, so it's the state of the building that was sometimes it's fall down or some detail, like one part by one part. And after the diagnostic, we also make the proposal of the restoration proposition. So I finish here, so thank you for your attention.